From Husky Stadium, it's a Class 3A battle at Northern Illinois. Two teams familiar with the state final spotlight. The Spartans hoping to break through for the first time in five tries, and Victory Valley looking to bring home a fifth state championship. Full day of football for you here at NIU's Husky Stadium. Two state champions already crowned. Congratulations to Lena Winslow and to Stillman Valley, or I should say, and to Sterling Newman. Stillman Valley and SJO are coming up next, and then you'll have Geneseo and Rochester later on tonight. Tomorrow, Montini going for 5 for 5. SHG trying to knock them off. You'll have Batavia and Richards as well. Lake Zurich and Mount Carmel, a defensive battle set to be in 7A. And then the 8A battle between Loyola and Naperville Central. Hi, everyone. Welcome into our broadcast. Matt Rothwald with you here at Husky Stadium. This should be a good matchup between two teams that have been here before. Stillman Valley going for its fifth state championship in school history. SJO, the Spartans, they've been here so many times before in the state finals level. 0 for 4 trying to get it done on this fifth try. Let's send it upstairs to the guys. We'll have the call for you. Dave Bernhardt and Boomer Grimsby. Guys.
Thank you very much, Matt. And, you know, you talk about two teams that are so accustomed to being here. Well, Boomer, Leopards don't change their spots. What these teams have done throughout the course of their history, we'll see it again here tonight.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Stillman Valley is going to stay true to their identity. They're a triple threat veer option team. And then St. Joe is going to stay who they've been all year long and been more of a balanced offense.
Well, let's take a look at that offense for St. Joe's. They diversify it a little bit. Orion Schotte has stepped up along with Connor James.
Orion Schotte is the real playmaker that they have. He's really emerged throughout the season as kind of a playmaker. He's more of a speed guy. I mean, they're going to look to get the ball on the edges there to him. You know, Connor James is the fullback, and the fullback that even last week was forced to step in and kind of play for Schotte and rush for over 200 yards. So either one have big play capability.
And on the defensive side of the ball for Stillman Valley, they'll make sure that number 39 gets it on the offensive side. That's Zach Heer. He, along with Connor McNames, the quarterback, boy, they make this flex bone go.
Well, Zach Heer has been a force to be reckoned with all season long. He's got over 1,500 yards rushing. Now, it's no secret the fullback and the veer option sets the precedent for how the entire game is going to be played and going to dictate how they'll run the rest of their offense.
We've got our 3A kickoff coming up. Stillman Valley, St. Joe Ogden. Will there be multiple state championships for Stillman Valley? Will the Spartans get their first? We'll find out next. Welcome back to Husky Stadium, the site of your 2013 IHSA state finals. Two in the books. We've got 3A coming up for you right now. It's a 4 o'clock game preceding 7 o'clock matchup between Rochester and Geneseo. But right now it's all about St. Joe Ogden and Stillman Valley. I'm Dave Bernhardt along with Boomer Grimsby. Let's check in with Matt Rothwald.
Valley coming into this one needing to or having a big win over Aurora Christian, and the fact is Zach Hare is healthy is impressive. He's had a left shoulder problem and a left knee. We'll see how healthy he is tonight.
Stillman Valley will get the ball first. The return up to the 27-yard line. Kelly Kroll working the St. Joe Ogden sideline.
Well, as you guys can imagine, for head coach Dick Duvall, it is his 26th year as head coach here with them. 301st game. This has been a very emotional week. And you know what? It could be his last game on the sidelines here, as he says he may finish up with teaching and coaching at the end of the year. And he goes, so I'm trying to embrace every minute with this team, just really soak it all up this week. And it's also very special to him that his son Kyle is on the sidelines with him tonight. So he's coached him, guys, and now he's coaching with him.
Well, thank you very much, Kelly. And no surprise, Boomer, first carry of the game goes to Zach here.
And we're going to see a lot of this. This is the formation that they're predominantly in. They're going to come out with this all game long, the flex bone formation.
High school, All-American at Illinois State University, an NFL veteran. You've never played against the flex bone.
In all my years of high school football and college football and even onto the National Football League, the flex bone was just never utilized.
We saw a lot of that type of action in the first game. Today, ball is being mishandled. Tristan Elliott is able to fall on it. It will be third down and long for Stillman.
Well, that's one of the weaknesses of the flex bone system is that, you know, there's a lot of, you know, split-second decisions, also tosses and pitches that guys really have to be, you know, sensing their tracks and have proper spacing. There's always a possibility for the ball to go on the ground a little bit more frequently.
Hare takes the hit, and he will come up about 2 yards short. St. Joe Ogden on the season, allowing only 18 points a game, number 59 on the stop. Jake Ron, the nose guard, 5'9", 205-pound senior. And it's three and out for the Cardinals. Marcus Bauer, in addition to his responsibilities on the defensive side, does the punting for Stillman Bailey. Averages about 40 yards per kick. It's a cold ball here tonight in DeKalb, and St. Joe Ogden will have great field position from their 46-yard line following just a 19-yard punt. Dick Duvall, 229 career wins. Finished second in 1989, 97, 99, and 2006.
You said St. Joe was more of a balanced offensive attack, but over the course of playoffs, they usually came out throwing the football.
Last two teams they beat in the playoffs, Williamsville and Greenville, were unbeaten. And here is the pass. Dalton Walsh. Dangerous part of the field. And it's incomplete.
Just a drop back pass. He feels a little bit of pressure and is forced to scramble outside of the pocket. His receivers do a good job of trying to scramble with him and get open. He doesn't have the ability to really plant his feet and throw the ball.
He was looking for a Hunter Hart. Hart may have had a little contact there on the defensive side. Number 10 for Stillman Valley, Logan Byers. Hart on the season, the leading receiver for the Spartans from SJO. On the ground, Shody. He gets almost 10 yards on that carry, averaging 7.5 per carry this season.
Shody has really emerged as a guy. This is just an outside zone. He hits it off tackle. He's got plenty of space. The offensive line does a great job of creating a little bit of space in the gap. He sees the cut lane and takes it upfield.
Now, Ryan Shody, we didn't expect to see a lot of him if you were a St. Joe Ogden fan at the beginning of the year. In fact, you didn't. It was Austin Hedrick that was running the ground game for SJO. Hedrick injured in week 8 after he gained 1,200 yards, but Shody has just come on exploded here in a postseason. Walsh after the first down. Dalton Walsh to scamper out of bounds. He was injured first two ball games of the season.
It's really incredible to have that kind of depth at running back, especially at some of the smaller classes of football. I mean, here we are in a 3A game where your leading rusher, you know, with over 1,000 yards on the season goes out, and another one has came on and emerged as just as much of a playmaker.
Well, last week in that win over Greenville, 44-21, after some guys got banged up, they had to go to people who had not played the tailback position since their freshman year, and still they obviously won by double digits. This time, Mr. Hart takes the hit. That will be another first down, though.
This is just the down pass. Receiver will turn right away to the line of scrimmage, catch the ball. They'll usually throw that whenever they see that the defense is in off coverage, in zone, and playing off the ball.
31st catch of the year, 456 yards, and 8 touchdowns coming in for Hunter Hart. The throwing side, Dalton Walsh has thrown for over 1,100 yards. A couple of first downs in this opening drive for St. Joe Ogden. That would be 5 yards marked off against Stillman Valley. Logan Alberts, number 2, jumping into the zone. It was a 3-and-out for Stillman Valley to start.
Stillman, still first down.
SJO taking advantage, good field position after a short punt on the move. Both these teams 11-2, two early losses for St. Joe Ogden. They were 2-2 after their first 4 games. For Stillman Valley, they lost their last 2 regular season games. Parker Medine on the tackle again. Only a couple. 35, Mark Stokes there as well. Now here's Shody up the middle. Shody is not necessarily your power back. That was Austin Hedrick. That was his role. Shody, though, getting a couple hard yards there.
Well, you can see on this. This is just a straightforward draw play. And it's the idea that with the bigger back that he would just come directly downhill following the fullback. He kind of abandoned him a little bit there. was able to be tackled.
Here's Shaw to the outside, but he will be upended. Great stop on the play for 88. It's Kyle Looking Glass.
This is just great. This is great tackling by Stillman Valley. They really flow to the ball. Shody's an outside guy. He's going for speed, but there's no lane for him to go through. It's a great tackle on the open field.
Looking Land, a 6'1", 190-pound senior. Third and short, Walsh to the air. The ball's incomplete after the deflection, so a big stop here. That was Looking Land again, maybe also getting a hand in there was Bruno Herrera, number 60.
This is a great play by Herrera. I mean, he realizes he's not going to get any pressure. The ball's going to come out quick. You know, to think fast enough to get your hands up, get your hands in the throwing lane, and get the deflection.
Bruno Herrera, huge for this team. After those two losses to win the regular season, it was Herrera that pulled the team together. And a fourth down. So Dick Duvall comes out throwing. He finds Jake Stewart from his quarterback, Dalton Walsh, and the chains will move.
This is a great throw and catch. I mean, they just go the simple out route, make sure that he gets to the marker, throws it, and completes it.
Jake Stewart will be playing collegiate baseball, but he's playing in a state title game, and he has his team on the move at the 17-yard line. That's number one, Jake Stewart, the 5'9", 150-pound senior. And number 39 does it on the defensive side as well, Zach Hare. 6'2", 230-pound senior. Hare, a straight-A student at Stillman Valley High School. No gain for SJO on first down.
It's a great play by Hare. SJO was trying to run the guard tackle. Pull. Hare just shot through the gap, came through the backside, made the tackle right at the line of scrimmage.
10th play of this drive for the Spartans. Walsh, time. He'll find his man. And inside the 10-yard line, Brady DePrett. So three different receivers have handled the ball on this drive.
St. Joe really spreading it out a little bit more. Knew they'd be a balanced attack, but thought that they would kind of establish more with the run up front, but they've done such a great job of spreading the field. I mean, they have the receivers, they have their wideouts out wide, and just kind of utilizing all of the space, realizing that Stillman is in his own coverage.
After a three and out, Stillman Valley defense is on the field now for the 11th play of this drive that started just beyond midfield. Walsh to Connor James. To the end zone. So Dalton Walsh has come out throwing, and he finds his fourth different receiver, Connor James, for the score. The 11th play of the drive that covered 54 yards and used up 4 minutes and 3 seconds off the clock.
Such a great play call. You see that a lot in the red zone. You see it a lot on fourth and short, you know, on the fire pass, you know, allowing the fullback to kind of come down, you know, miss the defender and release into the flat. Quarterback gets him the ball, and that was just pure heart. He lowered his head and ran right over the defender into the end zone.
Orion Shoney with the extra point. He's done it all, but so has the quarterback, Dalton Walsh. He's thrown the ball. He has found the right receivers. Connor James, the 7-0 lead for the Spartans. The 18th touchdown pass of the year for Dalton Walsh has given St. Joe Ogden the 7-0 early lead over Stillman Valley. Welcome back to DeKalb and Northern Illinois University. Mike Lawler, the head coach for Stillman Valley, as we said numerous times here, this is 6th trip that he has made. 4 of them have resulted in state championship trophies, 1999, 2000, 2003, and 2009. This kick will come up short to about the 17. And down to the 30-yard line. Let's go again to the St. Joe Ogden sideline and Kelly Kroll.
All right, guys, well, it's time for the Spartan defense to show us what they've got. And, you know, this was a different week for them. They're facing a power running game. It's something that Coach Duvall said, you know, they haven't really seen this year. So they worked all week at making sure they were able to come up with schemes, put their guys in the right place so that they could be successful this week. He goes, there's one thing you can't change in your players, and that's their size. He feels like they are undersized, but have certainly looked at film all week and plan to have his guys in the right place.
They will have their people in place for just a 3-yard pickup. And Boomer, back to the idea that you had not played against
an
offense like that. But what do you do in 7 days to prepare for something?
Well, that's one of the reasons that the offense is so difficult, and almost why it's feared, you know, at the level, is that, you know, it's a really hard offense to imitate with a scout team. I mean, it's so based on timing and precision. You know, for the backs taking their tracks and the quarterback actually having the read of whether he's going to hand the ball to the fullback or keep it himself or pitch the football. It's hard to train a scout team in order to imitate that.
Dings to the air, and the catch is made inside the 40-yard line. They'll put it down at the 42-yard line. Play action pass goes for 25 yards. They did this early in their win against Aurora Christian as well.
This has been very successful for them all year long. You've seen them in tape throughout the last couple of weeks that occasionally they will throw in a little bit of a play action. It's very hard to defend because the slot back arc releases in the same way that he does on a run play. So it's hard for the defender to tell whether he's releasing for the block or releasing downfield.
Jacob Huey had that long catch. McNames comes right back and he is dumped for a loss. Great penetration here from St. Joe Ogden.
See, everyone will decide how they're gonna play this option differently. This time they have the defensive end who has the quarterback. He does a good job of coming upfield and making the play.
For 71 was Seth Griswell. 6'1", 200-pound senior. McNames again. And that ball may be live. Nope, the whistles will blow. Oh, SJO fans thought they might have something there. They thought that may have been a lateral. Jake Stewart ended up in the end zone. Let's take a look. Was that parallel to the line? It went off the hands and right into the hands. Jake Stewart.
It's hard for us to see the angle, but you have that faith in the line judges there. But if it was a lateral, he caught the ball in the perfect bounce on the sprint. There was not going to be anyone in between him and the end zone.
Connor McNames averages 4 passes per game this season. He's already thrown a couple on this drive. Now the defense here early for St. Joe Ogden, they are not big. Their quickness has made a difference here in the first quarter. We have 4:40 to play.
Well, the coaches spoke up. Their strength is in their defensive backs within their secondary, and that's why throughout the playoffs they've matched up so well against the spread teams. But coming into this matchup, it'll be interesting to see how they'll make their adjustments and how they get their athletes involved in the plays. So far, they've been doing a great job.
Ball at the 40-yard line following that completion. Jacob Huey a couple of plays ago. And I believe Stillman Valley needs a timeout. They took a long time to get that play set from the sidelines. They'll take a timeout right here. We'll take one as well. 4:13 to play in the first quarter. First sustained drive for Stillman Valley. They're chasing 7.
The IHSA Football Championships are proudly presented by Country Financial. Achieve financial security.
We have a program alert for our Comcast SportsNet viewers. Tonight's 4A game will be seen only on Comcast SportsNet Plus. Comcast SportsNet Plus. Please go to csnchicago.com now to find the channel number in your area. We'll have this IHSA coverage at the conclusion of the Class 3A game in Chicago. And on 4th down and 8, Stillman Valley gets it big, and their huge contingent of fans come to their feet following the 19-yard gain.
This was a good time to call timeout. I mean, it's 4th and long in an offense that you're not really geared to throw the football. I mean, they find an opening, hit the receiver on. You know, the defensive back goes to make a play. And if you're gonna try to make the play, you either have to deflect it or make it. Otherwise, you have to be on your guy.
McNames went to Logan Alberts for that completion. 1st down, the drive continues. McNames, a short carry. It's an offense that averages 318 yards per game on the ground, averaging 32.5 points per game.
And this is the way that a majority of teams would like to defend the veer option. They like to put it in a position where they collapse on the dive and there's someone there to protect the pitch. They want to force the quarterback. They usually try to choose the one who's the weakest runner to run to the football.
McDames, nice little move. He'll get near the 10.
And that's why it's so difficult, even as a quarterback, to run this offense, is that it's a split-second decision right there, the mesh point of deciding whether he's going to hand the ball off to the football, hand the ball off to the fullback, or he's going to keep it himself. That time it was a good decision on his part. The fullback was already getting collapsed on. Pulled the ball out and took it downfield for a couple more yards.
First down for Stillman Valley. And here the pads crunching as the game inside the 10-yard line, trying to get a little bit of rhythm. That time the carry goes to Jacob Huey.
You'll see this as you get closer to the red zone. Stillman will go on a true double tight end wishbone look, and they just run a blast. They've got two lead blockers, essentially an ISO with another lead blocker, handing the ball off and trying to just smash mouth, run the football downhill.
Looking for the tying score. The pitch. Room to the outside. Micah Castronovo. An 8-yard touchdown run. Castronovo, not one of the leading rushers on the season. He had some key yards against Aurora Christian. He gets 8 key ones right here.
And once again, running the triple option, this time out of a true wishbone. The difference is now that you have both backs behind the fullback, they fake the dive as normally. He has a lead blocker along with the pitch man. Bringing it in double tight, you're also kind of bringing or condensing the defense. You're not allowing as many guys to be on the outside.
And with that extra point kick by Steve Kadeen, we are tied. So Stillman Valley answers the St. Joe Ogden drive with a 10-play drive of their own. It took 3 minutes and 45 seconds, covered 69 yards. Your 3A championship game locked up here at 7.
And that's just about as diverse as that you're going to see Stillman's offense. I mean, they're going to run a double-tight wishbone, and they're going to run, you know, the flex bone as well. But it was interesting on that. I mean, they had to go to it. They had some big plays early by throwing the football and how they were kind of forced to air it out a little bit. And what that does, it keeps your secondary. They have to honor that, and they can't pursue up front as aggressively on the run. But they will not change who they are. We will see nonstop, consistent, triple option football.
Connor McNames, 2 of 3 on that drive, throwing the ball. Good for 44 yards. We said coming into the game, McNames only averaging 4 passes per game. Big crowd here in DeKalb. Of course, Stillman Valley just up the road, just outside of Rockford. Not a very long drive for them. In fact, asking Mike Lawler, the head coach for Stillman Valley, what's different about coming to DeKalb than it was all those trips, those 5 trips he made to Champaign. He says, well, it's a heck of a lot easier. Don't have to worry about any catering, the crazy transportation, or any housing. Jake Stewart deep for St. Joe Ogden.
You know, a lot of these schools, a lot of the smaller schools, that the head coaches have such more responsibility. There's not as many people kind of supporting staff. So, you know, although it is a huge benefit to make it all the way through state to the playoffs and on to the state finals, you know, there's so many other little logistics things that they have to deal with along with the responsibility of coaching football.
St. Joe Ogden will get the field position at their 35-yard line. They've already played 2 games here at Husky Stadium. Of course, you're watching the 3A game coming up. It will be Class 4A Geneseo to take on Rochester. And again, a reminder for our Comcast Sportsnet viewers, go to csnchicago.com, because that ball game, the 4A game, will be seen at CSN Sportsnet Plus. So go to csnchicago.com, find out where CSN Sportsnet Plus is, and jump into that. But stick with us now here in the 3A game. We're tied at 7.
St. Joe motioning out to empty.
Walsh. He'll just dump it away. And you talk about spreading the field. That's what Dick DeBlow did right there. Man.
That wasn't a formation I was expecting from them. You know, they've shown early that they know they can throw the football, that they're willing to be aggressive with it. You know, spread out the football field. You put Stillman normally in the 4-2 or 5-2 front in a position that most likely they're going to have to defend it man-to-man. Stillman did a great job, though, and Walsh did a great job of not of not making a play worse. Simply throwing the football instead of going for the run and getting the sack or turning it over.
Well, trying to get to the outside. Great pursuit by the Stillman Valley defense. A defense that maybe doesn't get as much attention as they should in terms of their offense being able to grind it out. But here they come up big again. Short gain by Walsh.
And this play was botched from the very beginning. It appeared that it was going to be a quick pass right away. But right when he took the snap and turned and kind of ran into his fullback, James, it threw him off and he was forced to kind of scramble and try to gain some yards.
Number 20 there was Eddie Torrance, listed as a defensive lineman, but see him at various spots on the field. Third down and long now for the Spartans. And that play will go backwards. They tried to get the ball to Connor James. Well, indeed they did. That Cardinals defense had some other ideas.
This is just split flow by the running backs. They inch out into the flat. He gets the ball to James. Stillman Valley does just a great job of staying with their responsibilities and their assignments and pursuing the football.
78 was Xavier Watson, 6'3", 195-pound senior. He was on the step. Cole Berry, the punter for St. Joe Ogden, averaging 35.7 yards per kick. He was hoping for a good bounce, didn't get it. The Cardinals from Stillman Valley, the plus a minute to play here in the first quarter. Left great field position after a 26-yard punt. As you know, if you're watching the state of Illinois, we've had some brisk weather here. This is what it looks like at game time, 31 degrees. Really a good situation for these teams here today all through the day. The wind has not been very strong. This field here can become quite the wind tunnel if the winds do pick up.
The last few weeks of the playoffs have been heavily affected by the weather has played such a factor with the spread offense teams.
There is the strength and the power of Zach Hare. He gets about 4 or 5 yards after contact.
And this is what differentiates him. It's what makes him special. It's not that he's just a big back, but it's how hard he runs the ball. You see him lower the shoulders, continues to drive the legs. He's done that all throughout the season. And it's part of the systematic offense of a triple option that you continue to go to the dive. And the defenses will kind of chip away, but eventually it's going to break.
He put a licking on number 50, Wyatt Sage, number 4, Brady DePratt. They will stretch these chains out, and that is how short he will be from a first down.
That is exactly what you want in a big power back, though. You don't want someone who's trying to kind of make too many moves or dance too much in the hole. Someone who's looking to initiate the contact with the defender instead of receiving it.
Mike Lawler in a pretty good position right here on second down at about a foot. Lawler came bundled for the weather today. As did most of the folks that came here. A lot of noise here at Husky Stadium. Looking right in the eyes of Connor McNeil. That's the first down and a little bit extra. Hare, the workhorse for this offense, came into this game with 231 carries for over 1,450 yards, and he's starting to move the pile forward. Again. Boy, they're coming in chunks of 7, 8, 9, and 10 yards.
And this is one of the benefits of the veer option and how they can do this out of this flex bone set. I mean, the play before, they're running a true fullback dive as part of the veer option. That play there, they actually run more of an ISO where the wing kind of comes up underneath and is the lead blocker for the fullback coming downhill through the hole.
Same play. First down, Stillman Valley. At the end of one quarter, we're tied at 7. How did they do it? St. Joe Ogden, opening possession of this game. They take it down the field. Dalton Walsh, the quarterback. He finds Connor James, 7-0 Ogden. And for Stillman Valley, right back they come. It's Micah Castronovo. We're tied at 7.
Welcome back to Husky Stadium. Tie score as we head into the second quarter. And for the Cardinals, trying to get on the offensive side of the ball, Mike Lawler says he could have thrown the ball a little bit more throughout the regular season. You see, they only attempted 38 passes, yet against Aurora Christian, 4 for 8 for a good chunk of yards, 2 for 3 so far. Connor McNames, very complimentary, saying that he's a guy who could throw the ball a little bit more. And
McNames will get it off to him. I'll try the right side. That will go for about 4 on first down.
This is just attitude football. I mean, you see Stillman line up in double tight end, true wishbone fashion. I mean, they're making no secret of what they're trying to do here. They're running a straight blast play with two lead blockers, Zach Hare being one of them, with the tailback following them into the hole.
And about 2 yards short of the first down. There's Hare leading the way.
Exact same play, just switched it to the other side.
On the carry, it was Logan Elbers. There are the numbers for Hare, 44 yards in that first quarter. This may be close enough to bring the chains out. Nope, they'll go with it as is. Third and less than a yard. Zach Hare, 6'2", 230-pounder. That's first down. When they line up like that, there's no secret. I mean, it's almost from up high, it's, I dare you to stop this.
Oh, I mean, they're very confident in what they can do. I mean, they are just a normal flex bone, but when they go to a double tight, true wishbone, and then you have beast players the way Zach Hare is, I mean, I'm not sure people realize how large a 230-pound running back is. It's rare almost to see it at the National Football League level. I mean, I graduated high school and went to college on scholarship and didn't weigh 230 pounds.
Hare will get to the 3-yard line. Well, there you go. You know, NFL career that saw you at the linebacker spot, and you played 230-pound backs. Did you have to run head-on into?
Well, more ran into me than I ran into them.
Okay,
I think.
Okay,
but,
gotcha.
You know, he's such a big back, and if you notice, also what he does such a good job of, though, is a lot of bigger guys will have a tendency to run high, and he's very good at lowering his shoulders to at the line of scrimmage and kind of powering through.
There it is. Touchdown number 28 for Hare, and it's still McValley lead.
Play drive consisted of basically ISO. I mean, there was a couple that they led with two backs. We call that a blast when there's two guys coming on this. You know, they simply have one lead blocker, Hare behind it, a straight downhill, smash mouth, old school football.
Second time today, the conversion goes through. Keaton Weber will get the extra point, but it'll be Zach Hare, and why not? He drives him down the field, he'll get the last 3 yards. It's been a day of offense here at Husky Stadium in DeKalb, Illinois, Northern Illinois University. A cold day, but a 7-point lead for Stillman Valley about a minute and a half into the second quarter. St. Joe Ogden used to athletic success. Their boys basketball team last year finished fourth in the state in class 2A. In fact, they're already preseason number 3. A lot of these football players will suit up for that basketball team as soon as Monday. And a little chip. And that ball goes out of bounds. A lucky break for St. Joe. Let's check in with Kelly Krull.
Well, guys, we talked about the experience of Coach Dick Duvall. This is the fourth decade he has coached in a state championship game. And he mentioned, you know, I've actually coached Mike Lawler. And he meant coached against him when he was a player in 1989 in the Marion Woodstock team. And so there's a lot of history to this. And, of course, you know, Dick would like to get this one tonight, though. That would really cap off, I think, everything for his career.
That's right, Kelly, that 1989 victory by Marion Central was the first time that Dick Duvall brought a St. Joe Ogden team to the state finals. He's been here now 4 times past that. This is Chody. Chody will get about 6 on first down. Well, this is a pretty important drive here for SJO. They took the opening drive, took it down the field, and scored for the 7-0 lead. It was a pretty quick out the last time, and now after the Stillman Valley touchdown. Spartans will look to answer.
Well, you have to be able to capitalize on this. You don't want to be too far behind, you know, against a team like Stillman Valley that ultimately is going to stay who they are because of the design of their offense. They're going to eat up a lot of clock every time they get it, and they usually crush the time of possession category.
Jones will stay in the ground, good for a first down. Shoney will roll forward. He'll have it near the 48-yard line.
I tell you what, there's some really impressive hitting going on here tonight. I mean, we're four or five stories up, and I feel like you can hear the contact echo all the way from the field. Shoney also doing a great job. I mean, he's more of the outside guy. They're going to try to get the ball, get him to the outside, but he does a great job of also lowering his shoulders and keeping the legs going to get a couple more yards after contact.
Shoney, just a junior, at 170 yards and a couple of touchdowns rushing the ball in the second round win over Monticello. That was a 35-0 shutout. Shoney again. He was not going to get there that time. Eddie Torrance again stretching the play out. Number 20 pulls himself up off the pile for the Cardinals after a loss of four.
And this play was won by Stillman Valley at the line of scrimmage. SJO tries to run the guard tackle pull. Bruno Herrera does a tremendous job for Stillman Valley, just penetrating, getting in the backfield, getting in the way of the pulling guard and tackle, and disrupts the entire timing of the play.
Himself across midfield. He'll still be about 7 yards short of the first down. DePratt talking about the history and about his own personal feelings towards this game. He said, you know, we've dreamed about this since all these seniors were 6 years old. We've talked about it all the time. And that's a trait here of a Dick Duval team that's made it to the state final. Every team that he's brought, this being the fifth to the state final, has been very senior dominated. 17 seniors on this SJO roster.
And he said that you win with seniors. I mean, he's got a very senior-dominated team, and that allows him to play with a lot of experience.
Oh, pretty good time. And there. And a first down inside the 25-yard line. Dalton Walsh put it right on the money to Connor James for a gain of 24 and a first down.
A lot of this credit needs to go to the offensive line. They're actually doing a tremendous job. When St. Joe goes back to pass the football, they're really feeling no pressure at all from Stillman Valley's defensive front. It's giving him plenty of time for him to set his feet and make throws.
Offensive line of Ryan Potts, Jansen Sage, center is Seth Griswell, right guard Nolan Waller, and the right tackle Dylan Potts. Potts brothers are twins. Part of a long line of Potts in the state championship game. Shoney, a nice first down pickup. Boy, that last pass by Walsh, just laid it right over the defender, just dropped it right in into James.
Well, and that's, we discussed it earlier. You know, quarterback is the more difficult position to develop as a player. You know, there's a lot of guys on every high school football team in America that can throw a football, but whether they can throw it accurately, I mean, that was a complete touch pass. You know, I mean, he didn't have to gun it. He just had to float it directly over the defender's head to get it to his receiver.
5 minutes into the second quarter, and Joe Ogden trailing 14-7. And the numbers for Walsh. Short side of the field for Shoney. Will never go down, but he will get negative yardage. Loss of a couple.
St. Joe really likes to run the sweep out of this formation. You know, the difference, if he's going to get all the way outside, one linebacker does a great job pursuing inside out, but really the play is won at the line of scrimmage by the defensive back, who beats the wide receiver who's attempting to stock block on him. Well, that seals the edge and allows that there's no lane, there's no way for him to get around the outside and really turn on the burners.
Third down and 9, huge here in the second quarter for St. Joe Ogden, chasing 7. And now the whistles will blow. And Stillman Valley wants the timeout. They will get the timeout. That will be their second here of the first half.
Timeout, Stillman Valley.
St. Joe Ogden on the move. They have the ball inside the 25-yard line, down by 7. Welcome back to DeKalb. On a third down and eight, Stillman Valley takes a timeout. A good timeout in your eyes, Boomer.
Well, I mean, absolutely. He didn't like it was a trip set, and it was kind of bunched in very tight. And I don't believe that he was confident in the defense that he had chosen there in order to defend it. Whenever you have three receivers in there on the line of scrimmage, one on the line and the two off, you know, most likely they're going to be running some sort of crosser route, crossing routes.
Nothing to the right side for Walsh. He's staying with it. He has room to run if he wants it. And that will be caught in bounds, coming free for the pass at the 12-yard line. Good for a first down. Number nine is Hunter Hart. A gain of 12 on third down and eight.
Another just great example of fantastic play by the offensive line. I mean, he was really feeling no pressure due to the play. He kind of rolls out a little bit to his right. He still feels no pressure. You know, his receiver is smart enough to realize the quarterback is scrambling to try to come back to the receiver, try to break off of your route and come back to the quarterback in order to get open and make the play.
First down inside the 15-yard line. Over the middle to the end zone. Touchdown, Spartans. The touchdown catch will go to Clayton Silver of 12 yards.
St. Joe just really doing a tremendous job. It's impressive how well they're throwing the ball here today. And this is just simple kind of post route. The slot receiver is going down. He beats the man inside. A great throw. He's kind of finding a little window in between multiple defenders. But, you know, this is all stemming from the success that the offensive line is having defending the quarterback. Last week, Stillman Valley played a true passing threat team in Aurora Christian. And I think one reason they were so able to disrupt them is they were able to get a lot of pressure on the quarterback.
So Stillman Valley, the defense, gives up another score to St. Joe Ogden. And one thing you look at here, you know, we talked about how the offense for St. Joe Ogden diversified. I don't know that we would expect in this cold weather that Dalton Walsh would have come out and thrown the ball as effectively as he has.
No, I mean, they're definitely more of a balanced offense than some of the other ones that you usually see in a state finals game. But with that in mind, I wasn't expecting it to be kind of completely balanced. And more importantly, it's been more passing game. They found success early and have kind of really stuck to it.
Well, Stillman Valley on the defensive side, as we said, they played Aurora Christian last week. A very diversified offense. This is probably an offense that's maybe a little bit better than a lot of Stillman Valley fans may have thought. This St. Joe Ogden offense.
For sure. I mean, Aurora Christian is always just such a threat, you know, through the air. I mean, such a spread offense and just such a powerful team that can score so quickly. You know, but really how Stillman Valley was able to kind of win that battle was they were able to pressure the quarterback. You know, even if they didn't get to him and get a sack, you know, they forced him to scramble outside of the pocket. They forced him to throw the ball when he wasn't ready to. It messes up the timing of the routes and just the timing of all the patterns as well.
First touchdown of this game scored by SJO. Stillman Valley got the next two, and the Spartans answer for the 14-all tie, just under 6 minutes to play here in the first half of your 3A championship game. Had a pretty good return out beyond the 35-yard line. Return by Logan Alberts for 26, and this is what you have seen today and what's coming up. Lena Winslow, 28-21 winners over Tri-Valley. Newman Central Catholic picks up another title. You're watching St. Joe Ogden, and then up next, Rochester going for their fourth straight state title. Geneseo has four championship games. And a reminder to those folks watching with us at Chicago Sportsnet, that 4A game will be on Chicago Sportsnet Plus. And we'll tell you more about that and how you can find your way to see that 4A game as Zach Carey gets his first carry here on this possession of a tie game. Zach Hare. You talk about a guy that goes both ways. It's been mauled and does some mauling. You can barely read the number 39 on the back of his jersey. There it is. Scrape a little bit off here and there. Carey will go to the 44-yard line.
Well, anytime that it takes more than one guy to bring you down, the chances are there's someone hanging on your feet. You know, the majority of times that he's actually tackled is a swarm tackling effort by the defense, so he's taking shots everywhere.
Jacob Huey, the last carry, and a third down. 4 yards to go for the Cardinals. Yeah, that will be close. Logan Alberts at the carry. Elmer's third leading ground gainer coming into this season for Stillman Valley will give Mike Lawler and his club a first down.
First down for Stillman Valley at the 48-yard line.
Everybody stays tight. And here we'll just get it across midfield. You know, speaking of tight, folks that have seen this Stillman Valley offense through the years, I don't just mean in the last 4 or 5 years, I mean in the last 15, 20 years, not too much has changed. Now that look was a very similar look to fans had seen, but Mike Lawler has said, you know, we have changed a little bit. Sometimes we had to split some guys out because they don't have enough tight ends.
Yeah, I mean, he said that the one constant has been the triple option. But I mean, what can you do? If you just run out of tight ends, you got to utilize the personnel that you have.
Flag is down on the field here at Brigham Field at Husky Stadium. Mike Lawler in his 16th season, 158 wins.
Well, that's another reason that he's been such a successful head coach. I mean, some guys get a little too stuck in their ways, and then they don't really realize that schematically, if you don't have the proper personnel, you maybe can't run the offense that you desire to. So you have to understand what you have and use it appropriately. And, you know, I'm sure that it was something that he never thought that he would want to go from, you know, the double tight or even utilizing more split ends. But, you know, he found a way to utilize the personnel that he had and still be very successful doing it.
Second and 12. Harris not going to make it to midfield. That will bring up a third down and long.
Zach Harris on the carry. Tackle by number 50, Wyatt Sage.
So much heavy hitting going on here. I mean, you see Sage come downhill aggressively, but he's simply just outmatched physically by someone like Zach Harris. He does a good job slowing him down, but then that's what we see, we discussed earlier, you know, hold him up for a second, allow all the boys to come in and help you.
Dick Duvall looking on for St. Joe Ogden. Stillman Valley to keep it on the ground and nowhere. Boy, you can feel the pops. Number five, Chase Gatta, 5'10 junior.
Well, they're trying to run the counter here. They have a guy pulling, but Gatta just comes right through and just delivers the pop right at the line of scrimmage. Once again, I mean, every time that you see a Stillman Valley, you know, offender carrying the football, there's multiple SJO defenders swarming for the tackle.
There is Gatta. Again, not much wind to speak of, only about 9 miles per hour will not affect this kick. Up the 12-yard line. Stewart. Cracked down from behind. Officials, always an honor to find themselves working a state championship ball game. And here are the crew working for your 3A game. Gerald Iserman, Peter Merkel, Jeffrey Bryce, John Widmeyer, and Alan Jackson. Congratulations, gentlemen, your 3A championship game officials here tonight in DeKalb.
It was a great open field tackle by number 33, Parker Medine. It's actually been interesting this game. We've actually seen more punts than you actually normally do. I mean, one of the great things about high school football is that how often teams go for it on fourth down. And some of that is because, you know, also having a punter, you know, is a unique thing. It's rare for a high school football team to have just a genuine punter.
Shoney gets to the edge but can't turn it. The loose ball, I believe, SJO is on it. Back at the 6-yard line for a loss of 5.
Trying to run the fly sweep here with Shody. Gets the ball. Stillman just does such a great job pursuing and attacking at the line of scrimmage. The guys come in, the ball comes out here. I'm not sure who, but the SJO, Connor James, big play defending or jumping on the football. Otherwise, you're turning the ball over within the 10-yard line.
This is third down and long. Make that second down and long. And that clock winding down. Now remember, Stillman Valley has used up a couple of timeouts. Gatta, no gain. And the question here after the tackle by Logan Alberts, will Stillman Valley use their third timeout? And I believe they are right now.
Great play by Logan Alberts. I mean, you can see Logan Alberts. He is not your prototypical defensive lineman. The reason that you see him up there on the defensive line, and he is fast and he is quick. He sheds the block and is able to just get downhill, even though he's on the opposite of play side, and make the play in the backfield.
Alberts only 175 pounds. The defense for Stillman Valley this year, the average allowing about 15 points per game. They scored about 32 and a half on their own. On the other side, St. Joe Ogden, over 38 points per game scored. They started the season, St. Joe Ogden did, 2-2, and Dick Duvall said, you know, we've lost to a couple of good teams, but we just had to readjust, and they did make some changes, and have led to this streak here to the state finals game.
Another example of a coach, you know, these two head coaches have a tremendous amount of respect for one another. You know, they played against each other over the years. But Duvall had to address the team early in the year. You know, they've seen what their weakness was. They changed some of their philosophy, maybe something schematically, a little bit of personnel changes throughout the beginning of the season. And then the team continued to get better throughout the remainder of the season.
Those two losses early on came to Carterville and Clifton Central. Carterville was ranked number one in the final 3A poll. Clifton Central ranked number two in 2A. So they were not too many lightweights. Third down and big. On the ground with room, James. James will have a first down. Connor James had the hole and he had the moves. 18 yards on this run for James. What a run.
Simply an outside dive. James sees it. He sees the lane, though, cuts back. I think he actually knows where the yard marker is, but does a good job of lowering his shoulder, picking up the first down. Not a typical play call that you would expect out of St. Joe in third and long.
See how they like play this final 60-some seconds. They're going to go deep. And incomplete near midfield. The intended receiver was Hunter Hart. Under coverage for 40, Seth Van Riesen, 6'1", 150-pound junior.
Great job in coverage by Van Riesen. Ultimately, they're in a cover three look, so when you have a wide receiver flying down the football field, it essentially becomes man-to-man. He did a great job of not only being with the receiver, but turning around and trying to make a play on the ball.
Second down and 10. We have 61 seconds left. 77 yards to go. Stillman Valley out of timeouts. Boomer, is this something we may see SJO do, go big? Well, we're going to go draw. James running hard. And that ball may have fumbled in the pile. We'll say it's down at the 32. Just short of the first down.
They're going to go hurry up here.
They'll run the play. James has the first down to the 40-yard line.
James is running the ball with authority. I mean, to have a fullback that even last week comes into a game, which showed he gets hurt and rushes for over 200 yards. Now you see why he did that. I mean, he's very comfortable dotting the eye in the formation. He comes downhill, and very similar to Harry, he's a bigger guy that knows how to bring his pads down at the line of scrimmage and initiate contact with the defenders.
18 yards and 9 yards for Connor James. Let's go down to the field with Matt Rodewald.
All right, Dave, well, it's been a busy day here at NIU's Husky Stadium. We'll take a look back at the two state champions that have been crowned already and preview the Geneseo and Rochester game. As for this game itself, we will take a look at halftime stats, some highlights, and have a conversation with both head coaches here at the break coming up, Dave.
Sounds good. We're just 34 seconds away from that. Tied at 14. Talked about the diversity of the Joe Ogden offense. We have really seen it play out here in the first half.
Well, Stillman Valley has to respect how well SJO has ran the football, has thrown the football. So, I mean, you know, there's 34 seconds left in the half. Most likely they're more in a safer coverage. There's still plenty of field there. That way, they've been very successful running the ball on this drive, but you got to expect them to go to the air here.
And they will. To the sideline. And we'll stop the clock. Completion. We'll go to Chase Gottam. Short gain, about 6 yards. Stops the clock, 29 seconds.
And unless they take a shot, I think we're going to see a couple more of these where, you know, you're going to see 5-10 yard out routes. Give the ability to have the receiver become open, but then get out of bounds in order to stop the clock.
Walsh to the middle of the field. And that ball's caught. Oh, man. What a grab by Clayton Silver. He had the touchdown catch moments ago. 14 yards on this completion.
Great concentration by Silver. I mean, he gets hit right as he's catching the ball, manages to bobble the ball a little bit, but then bring it in.
You're talking about a state championship game, temperature about 30 degrees. You're getting hit from behind. You just have those calm hands to tuck it in.
It takes a lot of courage when the ball's kind of floated up there a little bit, and you know that it's coming to you, but there's a defender right behind you that you know right upon catching the football, you're going to get smacked.
Another timeout called by SJO with 22 seconds left. This drive started deep in our own territory, back at the 11-yard line. And the Spartans have just continued to push the ball forward. Now, if you're looking for a field goal for St. Joe Ogden, Ryan Schody is the field goal kicker. He's only attempted one field goal this year. He made it from 32 yards. So they're truly looking for six here. You have it at the 39-yard line. Dalton Walsh, a 6'1", 175-pound senior quarterback. It's time. Incomplete, and maybe actually a break that time for St. Joe Ogden. Hunter Hart dropped the ball. His knee also went down. Hart will be playing baseball at Indiana. Has a fastball clocked at 94 miles per hour. Hart, he was considering not playing football this year, but he said, you know, they're my buddies. I'm going to come and play again. Last year he was the Champaign News Gazette's baseball player of the year. Didn't play basketball last year to concentrate on baseball and realized he missed that camaraderie you have in a team sport. And the field is spread for Walsh. And somebody in the first row of the stands here at Husky Stadium may have made that catch.
Good job by Stillman Valley adjusting to the empty formation. That was a coverage play. I mean, the reason the ball was thrown away was because of how well the secondary was in coverage. You know, once again, they're not getting very much pressure though onto Walsh.
It's third down and 10. Be time for a couple more plays. And a screen. Inside the 30, clock winding down, and it goes to zero. Now let's just see what happens here.
You can see Duvall screaming from the sideline at the officials, hoping that they're going to blow the whistle due to the stop of forward momentum. We'll see what they decide here.
It's an interesting decision right here by the officials. And they're going to say that's it. Our first half has come to a close. Wow, we had a good one here in your 3A championship ball game. Each team answering each other at the end of one half. St. Joe Ogden, Stillman Valley tied at 14. Back at a chilly Husky Stadium, the folks have come here to DeKalb for the first time. We've had it in Northwestern, Illinois State University, Champaign, and now Northern Illinois University. And this is what the folks have seen, and you've been able to follow all day long. Lena Winslow gets that state title. That was a crazy ball game in 1A, and the Panthers end up winning it 28-21. Then in 2A, Newman Central Catholic out of Sterling flexed their muscles, took a 34-13 halftime lead, scored another time in the second half to defeat Staunton. A Cinderella story came to an end for the Bulldogs. Here at the half, it's 14-14, St. Joe Ogden, Stillman Valley, a pair of teams matching an 11-2 record. And a Of course, coming up at 4A, Boomer and I will be along. Great matchup between Rochester and Geneseo. But that's just day one. Here's day two. Start your day with us at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. Oh, baby, in 5A, Sacred Heart Griffin and Montini. Don't miss that. 6A, matchup, a rematch between Batavia and Richards from a game played earlier in the season. A lot of folks are looking forward to 7A. It could be a defensive battle. Does Mount Carmel get a title in 7A 1 year after winning it in 8A? They'll have to get past Lake Zurich. And then in 8A, Loyola Academy coming to the state finals. 12-1 record against Naperville Central. Let's go to Kelly Krull down on the field.
Thanks a lot, guys. Here with Dick Duval. And first of all, your offense. I think you have to be really impressed with the way you've been able to go through the air. Can you talk about that a little bit for us?
Well, I thought we needed to mix it up a little bit. So, you know, we came out with the idea that we were going to, you know, mix the run and the pass. And, you know, I think we got them on their heels a little bit. We're just going to have to continue to do that second half.
Defensively, you mentioned that size would be a factor. They're challenging on the offense. Zach Harris, how do you guys stop him?
Well, I don't know how we're going to stop him. I think we're going to have to get more people to him. And obviously, if we concentrate everything on the fullback, then their quarterback's going to run or their tailback's going to run. So we just got to keep on doing assignment football. I think, you know, if we continue to do that, you know, eventually I think we're going to get it figured out.
What were one of the other adjustments that you maybe pointed out to your guys just a few minutes ago?
Well, I think, you know, there's a couple things we can do offensively with our passing game. And then defensively, I think we're going to make a little slight adjustment with our defensive line to hopefully stop the off-tackle play a little bit.
All right, Coach, good luck in the second half.
All right, thank you.
There you guys go. You can see a few adjustments he said on the defensive line, so we'll keep an eye on that.
All right, thank you very much, Kelly. And one of the words that stuck out in my mind, Boomer, was assignments. Now, against the flex bone, what type of assignments is St. Joe Ogden looking at?
Well, I mean, it gets referred to very common, you know, within the business of playing assignment and gap accountable football. But ultimately, that's the simplest way to describe it. I mean, every guy has their role on the defense. Someone is assigned to the fullback on the dive. Someone is assigned to the quarterback if he's going to keep it. And then someone else is assigned to the pitch. And that's why that's a triple threat veer option that every single play somebody has to maintain their role because you're not sure which one of the three threats they're going to utilize.
On the other side of the ball, the Stillman Valley defense. We have seen them really make it tough for Orion Schody. In fact, didn't see Schody in that very last drive. But stretching the field does not work so well, the horizontal stretching, for St. Joe Ogden.
No, I mean, St. Joe, they've done a great job of establishing the pass. And it's something that maybe some of the adjustments that they'll make at halftime is they've seen their opportunities within the passing game, and they realize that they're not getting any pressure on their quarterback. So he has the ability to sit in the pocket and throw the football. So I'm assuming that the coordinators have looked at it, made some changes. They'll come out with some new routes and a new form of attack through the air.
Matt Rodewald is on the Stillman Valley sideline. Matt, what's going on there?
Well, I'll tell you what, just trying to get to this point has been impressive for Stillman Valley. A week ago, getting a win over Aurora Christian, they had a 13-game playoff winning streak, and Aurora Christian, the two-time defending state champs, got knocked off by the Cardinals at home, doing so with a 12-second left touchdown from Zach Hare. He's a guy who says, you know, this was a dream come true. You talk to Mike Lorler, he says this is one of the more unbelievable games that he had been involved in, and here they are a week later trying to show some toughness, trying to show some metal, and trying to figure this thing out. They win state championships in football, Dave, but they also have state championships in chess and in Scholastic Bowl, which means two things. You're either tough when you go to Stillman Valley, or you're really smart.
Well, it's worked successfully for the Cardinals so far. They're locked in a 14-all tie here at Husky Stadium in your 3A championship ball game. And a reminder, coming up next, 4A championship. Two storied programs, one a long history in Geneseo. A more immediate nature is against Rochester. There's your 4A matchup. And again, a reminder for our Comcast Sportsnet viewers, that ball game will be seen on Comcast Sportsnet Plus. Now, all you have to do to find out what channel to head to is go to csnchicago.com. But again, 4A championship ball game will be seen on Comcast Sportsnet Plus. Kelly Krull, Matt Rodewald, Boomer Grigsby, and Dave Bernhardt here bringing you this 3A matchup, and as we said, the Spartans from SJO will get their hands on the ball first. Folks from St. Joe Ogden, their championship site in the last several years has been Champaign. It's only about a 10-mile drive. They had to make the long drive here to DeKalb. There's the flip-flop for Stillman Valley. One half of football to be played, and no chances taken here. And Ryan Schody in the game, and again, tries to get the outside. He can't do it. He's run down from behind by Eddie Torrance. But the one question we had was answered. Schody evidently healthy enough to play in the second half. So the defense for Stillman Valley, they got their 18-minute breather there at the half. They'll get on to the field. You saw the yardage differential, 20-yard total offense differential for St. Joe Ogden. Advantage Spartans. They will start from the 27. And quickly to the air. And about 7 yards on the completion to Jake Stewart.
This runs a little comeback route. And what they've really done here is they've seen that Stillman is going to play off coverage. So anytime they're going to throw, they know that the now pass is always open or the comeback. And Stillman's going to have to make an adjustment if SJO just continues to do that kind of methodically down the field.
Shody kept pushing and pushing. His feet kept moving. Did he get enough for that first down?
That's the dilemma that you get in, though, as a coordinator. You know, I mean, when you're not, you know, an extremely confident secondary, which most are not at the high school football level, you don't want to play a lot of man coverage because you worry about giving up the big play. So you play a lot of cover three, cover four zone, where your secondary is kind of off the receiver and backpedals from the beginning, and you're willing to give up the short pass underneath.
See, Dalton Walsh's number is 13 of 19. Of those 13 completions, they have gone to 6 different receivers. And a first down for that run by Shody. And we'll see whether, yes, they're going to say the catch was made inbounds. Dalton Walsh, a senior quarterback, when he was a freshman, head coach Dick Duvall said he just saw something in this young man that he was going to be a good one. And in fact, he has come all the way to championship game. Dick Duvall says, not a surprise. But that freshman year, such a tough one for Dalton Walsh. In the summer of that, before the freshman year, he lost his mother in an automobile accident. She was also the cheerleading coach at St. Joe Ogden. This group of teammates just rallied around. They stuck together. Now here's Walsh bringing a title game his senior year. James the carry inside Stillman Valley territory. Connor James running hard for yards.
They go to the pro set by bringing James in the backfield, and they end up just running ISO with Shody actually as the lead blocker. And Connor James has really showed. He showed last week by coming in and taking over for Shody, rushing for over 200 yards, but he's been very successful, you know, the drive before half and even now at taking the ball and moving downfield with it. He's a bigger back. He's better to run in between the tackles.
As his coach Dick Duvall says, he's a physical specimen. They've just been on him to play a little bit harder. Well, he's doing it here in a title game. And again, good first down gain to about the 38-yard line.
And he talks about mixing it up. And I mean, here's what you do. I mean, you spread them out wide. You're twin sets each way. You know, you throw the ball a couple times, and then you run the quick fullback dive right the middle.
Dick Duvall, as we said, and Kelly mentioned in the pregame, maybe coaching in his last game. He hasn't decided whether he's going to retire yet. Seems to be enjoying himself, even though the expression may say otherwise. And there's a completion to Hart. And looking land didn't find the ball. On the other side, Hunter Hart sure did for 20 yards.
This is a great throw by Walsh. Barely gets it over the defender's head, but they had the route, they had the timing down. I mean, he's really shown a lot today that he has a lot of touch with the football.
On a cold day. Not the nasty weather conditions that a lot of folks suffered through last weekend, however. First down in the red zone for the Spartans, looking for a go-ahead score. Big hit, great timing on the play, on the stick. For 40, Seth Van Riesen. He timed that right on contact with the ball.
Trying to run the cross route, just doesn't really get the football to him fast enough. But they're setting up in this pro set with the split backs. You've seen the screen earlier before half. I'm expecting that'll be something that they go back to here. I mean, both the running backs kind of inch towards the line of scrimmage, looking to chip block it all. It could leak out.
Clayton Slifer, the intended receiver, Shody the carry inside the 15. The whistles continue to blow on number 77. And finally tracking that down as Jansen Sage. This ball was down at the 13-yard line. Clayton Slifer, that 12-yard touchdown pass, one of the 6 receivers. That was the last score we had in this ball game. It came at the 5:59 mark of the second quarter.
This is exactly the kind of drive that you want when you come out of the halftime. I mean, the game is tied 14-0, and it's kind of whoever's going to gain the momentum.
Walsh looking left all the way. And it will be fourth down.
Tries to get him just a little bit on the out route, and the ball just doesn't quite get there.
Into the tie ball game in your 3A championship matchup. 3 minutes into the third quarter, a fourth down and five, and St. Joseph Ogden will go for it. Chody, the only man in the backfield with Dalton Walsh. Walsh waits, waits, waits. The catch is made. Did he get it in bounds? He did. First down, Spartans. Jake Stewart able to tiptoe the sidelines. Take a look.
So they roll Walsh out to his right. They lead with Connor James up front, just sealing the edge to kind of give him some more time. And this is a great job by the receiver, catching the ball near the out of bounds, making sure that he gets both feet down.
Stewart gets that foot in, and as soon as that happened, that's a first down and goal for St. Joe Ogden, opening drive of the third quarter.
Either way, great play by the receiver. Again, my NFL rules mixed with high school, the 2 feet to one.
The carry up the middle, James Powers. And they will say he is inches short. Stillman Valley says there's a loose ball in that pile.
The ball definitely came out, but not sure whether they'd already blown the whistle for forward momentum.
Nobody's moving. That's where the ball will be. We'll take a look and see when that thing squirted out of there.
This is just the lead, but Connor Jane does such a great job, though, of keeping his feet moving after contact. I mean, his initial contact was at the line of scrimmage. You can see the ball come out, assuming because there was no change of possession, that they'd already blown the possession dead due to the stop of forward momentum.
That's how far St. Joe Ogden is away from taking the lead in this one. Shoney, head down and in. Orion Shoney will give St. Joe Ogden the lead. A 3 minute 59 second drive.
They're really mixing and matching this up with using Connor James as the fullback this time and Shoney as the tailback in the I formation. How, you know, earlier in the possession going down the field, they would kind of alternate it and Shoney would be the lead blocker. But, you know, great play call, first down, or 1 yard from the goal line. Give it to one of your backs, but moving the ball successfully, allow them to lower the shoulders and pile in for one.
And that extra point is no good. A 6 point difference here in NIU at Husky Stadium. But a long drive leads to a St. Joe Ogden advantage, 2014. That sideline feeling pretty good right now. 21 mixed feelings. That's Orion Shoney. Had the touchdown run, the missed extra point could loom large.
We'll see how the game plays out, but Stillman Valley is just such a difficult team to stop offensively. St. Joe has done a good job of getting a stop here and there and slowing them down, but they're still the kind of team that, you know, is capable of the big play.
Saw the 5 minute time of possession advantage for St. Joe Ogden. Logan Albert. Just about the 35 yard line.
You get an example of Logan Albert's athleticism. He's the kickoff return man, but he also plays defensive tackle at times. That kind of shows his diversity and the reason they put him on that front line in order to kind of utilize his quickness.
Connor McNames will bring his team to the line, and look at this. He has a couple of wideouts. Double wing look. Hare will carry for about four.
Zach Hare is ball carrier.
Zach Hare rushed for 67 yards on 13 carries. 5.2 yard average, had a touchdown. His long run was 10 yards. That was first half numbers.
Three is second down and seven.
nothing has changed. I mean, they have came out of half, and you can still hear the pads smacking around on both sides of the ball.
Again, they're hitting it quick up the middle to about the 45-yard line. Be about a yard and a half short of a first down. He just may ride that big man. Here had a 228-yard, four-touchdown game, a quarterfinal win over Winnebago. That avenged one of the two losses for the Cardinals. And you heard the pads pop there. No game. Number five, Chase Gatta.
Outstanding play by SJO. Chase Gatta just comes directly downhill. There's zero hesitation. Just that is exactly the way that you want a middle linebacker coming downhill, making contact behind the line of scrimmage.
On fourth down, they give it quickly to Hare. He gets into SJO territory at the 48, move the chains after an 8-yard gain. And they are getting to the line in a hurry, changing the pace of this game. Not who carries the ball. Let's go down to Matt Rodewald.
You know, what's interesting, Dave, is being in a state championship caliber game like they were last week against Aurora Christian and trailing the entire way against the Eagles, they already are in championship mode where this one's nip and tuck on the state final stage. This should help them be calm as they head in towards the fourth quarter.
When you have a head coach that's been around for five state championship ball games, that helps. But the same could be said for St. Joe Ogden, their defense showing great quickness. Number 60, Jordan Hartman, one of the men involved. Number 71 there is Seth Griswold. We called his name a couple of times. There's a lot of white jerseys. And it's third and long. To the outside, and a first down and goal. To the 20, 15, Jacob Huey. Big game for Stillman Bailey. 34-yard run. Well, they pound you at the middle with Hare. And here comes Huey on a pitch.
This is exactly how they do it. This is why this offense is so difficult to defend, is that they will systematically just kind of inch away, pounding you inside, and then occasionally go for it, take it to the pitch, take the ball outside.
Say Huey stepped out at the 14-yard line, a 30-yard pickup. Powerful football forward inside the 10. There the carry again, reminding you, 6'2", 230 pounds. They go very quickly to Hare. Reaches. The ball went into the end zone and touchdown. Well, an F ball squirted around on the goal line. It brought a few people's hearts to their throats in Stillman Valley. Hare with that touchdown run that he had against Aurora Christian. Similar play where the ball came free, but it's a tie score after the 8-yard touchdown run. And the big extra point coming up. Keaton Weber, soccer player at Stillman Valley, for the lead. They sped the offense up. They got the line to the ball in a hurry. Zach here reaches. He scores. They lead. Number 39 is Zach Hare. He has two touchdowns tonight, and he pounded St. Joe Ogden in that touchdown drive and on that touchdown run, the extra point, the difference in this game.
Well, they knew coming in, I mean, they were going to ride the horse that got him here. I mean, this kid is he's just a Clydesdale. I mean, he is a monster when he has the ball. I mean, he's so unbelievable at gaining yards after contact and just kind of keeping his shoulders down. He's always falling forward, continues to drive his legs. He's a big-time player. We'll see him playing college football somewhere.
He is the Illinois Football Coaches Association All-State selection. He's carried his team to a one-point lead, 4:55 to play in the third quarter. Thank you. SJO will get decent field position as we go back and forth here in this 3A game. Each team answering the call. As Matt Rodewald said a little bit earlier, after playing Aurora Christian in what felt like a state championship ball game, it was a relaxed Stillman Valley team then, a relaxed team here tonight. You get the feeling on the other side of the field, that's how they'll play it as well. There's your scoring drive. We haven't had any quick drives here tonight. They've been long, sustained drives. This one, 9 plays, 64 yards. Great field for Wolf. First down into Stillman Valley territory. Connor James getting the ball every which way he can.
They spread him out, run an empty formation, put Connor James on the inside and let him just run a bubble. Still catch Stillman Valley in a zone coverage. Ultimately, what you do is you're getting the ball in the hands of your playmakers out wide, forcing Stillman Valley to make a one-on-one tackle.
After that 14-yard pickup, one snap of the ball, SJO into Stillman Valley territory. Motion for James, time for Welch. He's got a lot of room to run. And he'll go down, gets about 7 yards. I was waiting for Walsh to do this a couple of times here tonight. He saw the opening.
Well, it's a good decision by Walsh. I mean, you see him drop in the pocket. He's looking to the right. He goes through his read progression. He doesn't have a receiver open and able to throw it. Sees the opening to his left and takes it for positive yards. It's always better to take some green when you got it than force a throw.
178 yards of offense tonight for the senior quarterback, St. Joe Ogden. On the ground looking for the first down, and James will be close. Maybe enough. Looks like they've put it just inside the 39-yard line, and it is another first down for the Spartans.
SJO has done exactly what Coach talked about at halftime, is they really came out. You know, they knew they had to mix it up a little bit early in the game, but they've kept the same mentality and even diversified it even more in the second half by, you know, utilizing the run here and there, spreading it out to empty, going with split backs and the pro set in the backfield.
18th first down of the night for St. Joe Ogden. Rebound game. Stillman Valley 263 to 214, yet they trail by a point on the scoreboard. And the Spartans will use a timeout here, the 318 mark of the third quarter. This is game number 3 of 4 here today in DeKalb. Earlier on, you saw Lena Winslow knock off Pry Valley, Newman Central Catholic, another state title, their fifth. A 40-13 win over Staunton coming up in 4A. Rochester will go for their fourth in a row against Geneseo. Green Machine, the Maple Leafs of Geneseo. Three consecutive state titles in the late 70s. They added another one in the 80s. It'll be an interesting matchup. Boomer and I will be here for that one, along with Kelly Krull and Matt Rodewald, our Comcast Sportsnet viewers. You're watching this game right now. We'll be switching over for that ball game to Comcast Sportsnet Plus. You can find out your channel in your area by going to csnchicago.com.
I don't believe that SJO had lined up in a proper formation based on the way we've seen Duvall coaching on the sideline when they came over.
It's a timeout used early here in the third quarter that could prove big late, much as the missed extra point on their last touchdown. It's a first down. James joins Walsh in the backfield. James gets the hand up. Connor James powers forward. He's got about 10 yards on that carry. And boy, is Connor James coming up big. We talk about Zach here. James is his counterpart. Maybe not quite as big, but he runs just as hard.
He's playing a tremendous football game right here. I mean, he's a bigger guy, but notice how he kind of leans in order to kind of scrape right behind his offensive lineman. And then the moment he pops through, just goes vertical. He's not a guy who's going to try to dance too much or move too much. He's going to bring the shoulder down and go downhill.
6'1", 200-pounder. Another first down. To the air. To the sideline. To Stewart. run that pattern a couple of times. Walsh continues to be very efficient. That's his 18th completion in 26 attempts now here tonight.
Once again, he's feeling no pressure. He knows that Stillman Valley is in his own coverage. The defensive backs are playing 10 yards off the receiver out on the edges, so they're going to be able to get that little quick out route all day long.
After a gain of five. Second down and five. Shoney up the middle. Orion Shoney keeps pushing those red jerseys back. The gain to the 12-yard line. And yet another first down after a gain of 11.
This is a great job. I mean, you see the kind of the counter blocking, crossing, a little misdirection. They really caught Stillman off guard here. Throughout the season, when they were ever in that tight trips formation, SJO has done a lot more of either throw the ball or they'll run the sweep to the trips. That time bringing the ball back inside, Chody finds a huge hole.
Walsh under center, the pitch to Chody. Talk about folks close to the ball. You get about six white jerseys, six red jerseys in the middle of that, number 21, Orion Chody. Now St. Joe Ogden inside the 10-yard line looking to retake the lead.
Now that play, they aligned in the same formation, but then ran the sweep. He's done a great job this half of not only mixing and matching, you know, between the pass and the run, but his formations and utilizing from trips to, you know, to twins each side to empty.
Inside the 5-yard line, close to another first down. Chody again.
Ryan Chody on the carry. Tackle by 60. Bruno
just an inside lead. I mean, all the linemen are base blocking. He finds a way in order to edge around the offensive guard. Goes for another couple yards.
Third down and two at the 4-yard line.
This drive started back at their own 37-yard line and has now reached the Stillman Valley 4. James to the outside.
Touchdown, St. Joseph Ogden, Connor James,
and Spartan touchdown. It was Shoney, then James.
That's a great play by Connor James. I mean, I tell you what, you see SJL aligned in the power eye. They're going to run the football. Both lead blockers bring it downhill. He honestly should have followed his lead blockers, but either way, he bounced it outside, and just his pure heart and desire and the way that he's been churning his legs and keeping his shoulders down piles into the end zone. But the play is designed to follow his two lead blockers. I mean, simply, you know, a blast play running the ISO out of the power eye.
After missing the extra point the previous time, St. Joe Ogden will go for two. They lead by five. Play action. Throw back the other way, and they get their two. Walsh to James, and it's 28-21. Spartans.
We talked about it. They've been setting that up throughout the entire first half, even in the drives through this third quarter. You know, I mean, they run the play action. The fullback sneaks out into the flat. You know, somebody has to realize, somebody has to have them. It was a great play goal, aligning twins the other side. You know, you even had your quarterback roll out a little bit that way. No one's looking for the fullback, Connor Jane, to escape out through the flat, the backside.
That drive by St. Joe Ogden answering the touchdown drive of Stillman Valley took 9 plays, 63 yards, and 3 minutes and 53 seconds off the clock, and it all adds up to a 28-21 lead for number 7, Dylan Walsh, and the St. Joe Spartans.
It's a huge 2-point conversion. I mean, either team has struggled stopping one another, and so, you know, missing the kick earlier and going down by one, if you're going to continue to play that game, you have to respect the fact that Stillman is scoring. So going for two and having the conversion, such a huge play.
62 seconds to play here in the third quarter. Dalton Walsh, what a night the senior has had. He'll strap that helmet on and play a little defense. In fact, for Walsh, you know, Dick Duvall in all his years never had a quarterback play defense, just didn't want to take a chance on a quarterback getting hurt defensively. But Dalton Walsh was out the first couple of weeks. In stepped in Eli Olteen for St. Joe Ogden. Olteen did a great job, threw for 463 yards. So Duvall says, you know what, I'm going to take a chance and have Walsh play some defense. Nobody wants to kick the ball deep here tonight, and Stillman Valley will get good field position at their 42. Let's check in with Kelly Kroll.
Well, guys, Dick Duvall said coming into this half, you know, they were going to have to get creative defensively. And I just watched Bob Glazer pull his group aside and say, all right, guys, here's what we're going to do. The outside linebackers, start watching them go after the quarterback, because he can tell some of his guys are getting a little tired. But by no means did you see them by any stretch of the imagination start to say, oh, what are we going to do? He said, this is what we're going to do, pumping his guys up. And certainly that's something to keep your eye on here.
Very good. Thank you, Kelly. And an interesting point that she brings up, the coaches bring up, the idea of fatigue, having to pound on a tackle like a number 39 or a number 25 on the other side, Heron and James.
Well, it's another reason that the triple option is so successful. And as the game goes on, you know, fatigue starts to set in. People start to have more mental breakdowns. They start to get tired. You know, they start to feel the contact that they've had the entire first half of the game of those nonstop dives. And then, you know, mental mistakes are a lot more prevalent, along with missed tackles.
That penalty will go against Mike Lawler's team, the Stillman Valley Cardinals, an illegal procedure call. Been relatively free of penalties here tonight. Set up a second down and 10. Remember the quarterback, McNames, cleared a couple of passes in the first half on a scoring drive, but they'll just plow it up the middle. Short gain to Hare, and that may be the last play here in the third quarter.
STO has done a great job with their defensive tackles. They have them lined up, you know, outside of the guards, but they're doing such a great job of crashing down and making contact with Hare.
He will power forward. He will get inside the 50-yard line. A 3A champion is going to be crowned. We'll have 12 more minutes of football. Three lead changes in the third quarter. The final one belonging to St. Joe Ogden. They lead it by 7. It's a 28-21 lead for St. Joe Ogden entering the fourth quarter. This is your 3A championship ball game. Coming up next, we'll have 4A action to wrap up today's events, Rochester and Geneseo. And just a reminder for our Comcast Sportsnet viewers, we'll be switching away from our IHSA coverage at the conclusion of the 3A game. So all you have to do is go to csnchicago.com, find the spot for your CSN Plus channel number in your area, and switch over for the rest of tonight's coverage. That, of course, the 4A game coming up after this one. We start the fourth quarter. Stillman Valley, the ball in St. Joe Ogden territory. We have been going back and forth all night. They'll ride the big man forward inside the 45-yard line. Nothing that Nick Duvall can do about that. I mean, he can have people fly to the ball, but then he could get burned on the outside. We heard him talking to Kelly at halftime about that. Not much you can do when you got a 230-pounder coming your way.
We knew what to expect. They tried to pinch everybody into the A-gaps, but, you know, Perry just simply took that one out to the B and got the first down.
Huey the carry. There your rushing yards tonight. Stillman Valley approaching 200 yards. St. Joe Ogden a little bit more balanced attack with the 135 yards on the ground, 170 in the air. There the carry. People hit him. It takes a couple to bring him down, and he will be about 2 yards short of a first down.
Such heavy contact occurring. Stillman Valley knows what they're trying to do. They're in double tights. They're in a true wishbone set. You know, they're going to be running the football downhill aggressively, and SJO is doing the best they can of trying to come down and meet them at the line of scrimmage.
There, the little slide step gets him through the line. The extra step gets him to the 28. And yet another first down for the Cardinals.
This is so difficult to defend. I mean, they double block. Wing comes in, leaves the way. Hair comes downhill and just follows the block.
Nothing new, a little bit different formation to the 26-yard line. And this is the Stillman Valley team that lost their last two games of the regular season and won their first seven. Then back-to-back losses to Rockford, Lutheran, and Winnebago by scores of 33-28, 26-20, avenging that loss to Winnebago in the quarterfinals. They have regrouped, and here they are. Hare at a full head of steam as he plows inside the 20-yard line down to the 17. Well, he's coming right at you. You stop it. Brady DePrett with the tackle.
First down, Stillman Valley at the 17-yard line.
Now Hare, the sidelines. He left the Aurora Christian game a couple of times. In the semifinal, they'll give the ball to his replacement, Eddie Torrance. And the drive continues as Torrance gets a little action here on the offensive side.
And they've stayed very consistent with this when they're in the double tight wishbone look. You know, I mean, they're just running another form of ISO with one of the backs leading the way and handing the ball to the fullback. SJO is doing a great job. You just got to stop them a little bit shorter in order to try to get them in a position where they're going to be behind the chains. Stillman Valley is very comfortable with three, you know, little gains because they know eventually they're going to break one.
So Torrance takes his team to a first and goal, and Hare comes back in the ball game. Stillman Valley down by 7. Hare, both hands around that football, down to the 3.
Hare on the carry.
That is his 28th carry of the night. Hare now up over 140 yards, 141 to be exact, has a couple of touchdowns.
And you can see that he's wearing down a little bit. I mean, nonstop contact, all the rushing attempts that he's had.
It'll be third down and goal.
A little bit slower getting up, but that's what happens when you're 230 pounds and they just keep feeding you the ball, feeding you the ball. And then, you know, I mean, he's had less big plays than in normal games. A lot of times, you know, he'll have some of this consistent contact, but then he'll break one for 30, 40. I mean, last week there was multiple different chances that he broke through the line for large gains.
Here he is met head on. What a stick that time by number 60, Jordan Hartman. A senior.
So much contact. I mean, this Jordan Hartman, defensive tackle, you know, meets at the line of scrimmage, slides through it, just perfect form tackle, puts his face mask right in the middle of Torrance's chest.
14th play of the drive, fourth down and goal. They'll pitch it to Alberts. Can he get to the edge? He dives, he's in. Touchdown run, Logan Alberts makes it a 1-point game. So they go wide to Alberts, the 5'11", 175-pound senior. Dalton Walsh can't get him in time. And now the important extra point coming up, the extra point attempt for Keaton Weber. You'll look right at it. This for the tie. And there's your answer, but wait. We've got the extra point, and we've got 8:20 to play in this game. The touchdown by Alberts, the extra point by Weber, 28 all.
The IHSA football championships are proudly presented by Country Financial. Achieve financial security.
There is your scoring drive, and we've had four of them here in the second half. Four possessions, four scores, 15 plays to cover 58 yards. We have 8:20 to play in this ball game, and we continue to go back and forth. Stieg the Dean to kick it off. I'll hit this one a little deeper. Shoney inside the 5. Orion Shoney to the outside. And St. Joe Ogden is in business across their 40-yard line. Well, they kicked it deep. Shoney does the damage. This will go for a 38-yard kickoff return. The ball ending up at the 43-yard line.
It's kind of an example of how sometimes when you see kicks that are kind of dropped or buffed, you know, this wasn't, but he had to pick it up off the bounce. And what it does is it kind of changes the dynamic of the kickoff team because it affects the timing of when he gets the ball. You know, some of the players are already downfield. They don't know how much they want to pursue in to close their lanes. Shoney took full advantage of it.
Well, in your NFL career, you were a great special teams player. What does that feel like as that's happening around you? on both sides of the ball.
Well, it's tricky. I mean, you see it a lot on TV. You see a guy even on a punt, sometimes he'll fumble it, and it's almost like that excitement brings in the defenders more, and so then he'll bounce it around the outside, and other times it just kind of puts them in a panic. They don't want to over-pursue when they're coming downfield.
Walsh stands in there. And this may have floated out of bounds. Yes, it did. Incomplete pass. The intended receiver was number 9, Hunter Hart. Glad you've joined us here in DeKalb, along with Kelly Krull and Matt Rodewald. My partner is Boomer Grigsby. I'm Dave Bernhardt, and it is just the third of four games you're getting today, and the third of eight games. So we'll get the entire weekend here. State championship football at Northern Illinois University. And a big third down here in this game with 7.5 to play for St. Joe Ogden.
Walsh has really been impressive. I mean, that's a very difficult throw to make. I mean, it was just a tad bit outside, just the ball sailed on him just a little bit.
They'll need 9. Looking left all the way. On the run, has a man, Stewart. Yes, he did. Again, Jake Stewart keeps a foot in bounds, and Walsh puts the ball on the money for 17 yards.
Great play by Walsh. I mean, he's sitting there in the pocket. He feels a little bit of pressure, but he rolls out. And to be able to make that throw on the run across your body, so impressive.
Key third down conversion and a great ball right there from Walsh. My goodness. He's playing like it's about 75 degrees outside rather than 30. Big numbers for the senior as well. Great protection. On a comeback, and he found him. Hart with the reception. Walsh, the presence, the calm demeanor, the game for 19, and another first down for the Spartans.
Doing a great, great job protecting him. I mean, Shody comes up here. You can see Shody, the tailback, actually blocking the end man on the line of scrimmage. And Walsh rolls out. These receivers are doing such a great job at working with their quarterback. The moment they see that he's rolling out, coming back to the football in order to separate yourself from the defender, make sure that you get your feet in bounds and come down to completion.
Ball at the 21-yard line. Play action. This toss goes to James. Short gain of about 5.
Run the play action. You see, as the fullback's running at the defender, a lot of times they're not exactly sure what to do. They're not sure whether it's a run play or whether it's a pass, and he just kind of slips them, finds his way open in the flat.
We have 7 minutes left. Every possession in the second half has resulted in a score. And off to James. About 2 yards short of the first down. You know, Boomer, this is a different type of shootout. This isn't one where a big 70-yard play. This is like sustained drives. That clock actually comes into play here with under 6:50 to play, because you could have the ball with 4 minutes left and drive it down to 0.
I mean, neither team has really had a big play, a huge play for a touchdown. I mean, both of them have just kind of patiently moved the ball downfield.
3rd and 3. To throw. And down he goes. Eddie Torrance. He will get the sack that will push the ball back to the 22-yard line. It will be 4th down and 11.
Huge play by Torrance, but this is an adjustment that Stillman Valley has made. You see them bringing pressure off the edge. That's something they did not do at all in the first half or in the third quarter. You know, the worry in that situation of why they probably most likely haven't done that is, you know, whenever you're bringing pressure, there's less defenders, there's less defensive players in the secondary, and usually it's man-to-man coverage. Great play call. Good job by Torrance.
On 4th down, they need 11. Walsh to the end zone. Touchdown! Hunter Hart, 22 yards on the 22nd completion, a record-setting completion from Dalton. Walsh in a championship game, and St. Joe Ogden the lead.
And there St. Joe does a good job defending it. I mean, they actually bring five. They're pressuring with five this time. So, you know, you don't have a cover four situation. There's only one safety back there, and they find the inside receiver running the post route.
Shody for the extra point. Nails it. Third touchdown pass of the night from Dalton Walsh. We've had touchdowns scored here in the fourth quarter. Both of them coming on fourth down. Here's a look back at the 22-yarder.
So he's got plenty of time to throw the ball. He's feeling no pressure. The offensive line did a great job. You know, the receivers, they realize that the receiver is coming down, but he's going to just run a post route. I mean, he goes around the first defender and cuts it in inside the safety, and he just cannot make a play on the ball. And there's no more help inside.
Hunter Mark very happy that he decided to play football this year after sitting out last season. He has the go-ahead score in the 3A championship game. Dalton Walsh, we said, broke the 3A record for completions. The previous record was 20. He now has 22 completions and 31 attempts for 232 yards tonight. Previous record set by Isaiah Olson from St. Joe Ogden. So the record book doesn't change where it was from, just who.
Here we go.
There's another nine-play drive.
Go, St. Joe, here we go. Here we go, St. Joe, here we go.
And 5:44 to play.
Here we go,
just
here
enough
go.
Time for Stillman Bill. Number 15. Elvis. He's not done. He takes it up to the 40-yard line. The Cardinals, after the 26-yard return from Logan Alberts, in business.
It's a great return by Alberts. I mean, he's coming down and chooses to take it all the way outside across the field. You know, Connor James is in pursuit, and they overrun the ball, and he finds an angle in order to come back and make some more yardage. And that's what you get. I mean, rarely, I cannot recall ever seeing a kickoff returner defensive tackle. So you get that sort of athletic ability in your return man.
First down, Stillman Bailey. Hare, he'll get five. Boomer, now you wonder with Hare. He saw a little bit of fatigue from Hare. He's just carried a ball for his 30th time. Can Stillman Bailey continue to give the ball to big number 39?
Absolutely. I mean, this kid has showed nothing but heart all year long. I mean, this is the state championship game. You know, they're down by a score.
He has it again. He has a big hole on here. He gets through. Oh, my. Brandon Pratt, the tackle. Let's go down to Matt Rodewald.
Right now, limping off the field with that left knee. This is the exact same thing that happened a week ago at Aurora Christian. On the final drive, in the final 2 minutes, he limped off the left knee, came back in, and eventually scored the game-winning touchdown. We'll see if he comes back.
First down into St. Joe Ogden territory to the outside. Eddie Torrance will bring it down inside the 25-yard line. Whether it be Torrance or Hare, big game. 41 yards on the last two plays of this game from Hare and now Torrance.
23-yard line.
And you get a look at Zach Hare being worked onto the sidelines. Torrance had a hole. It was closed quickly.
Well, Stillman Valley does not feel any pressure due to the clock right now. I mean, they're moving the ball efficiently. And let's not forget that last week, you know, they came from behind the majority of the second half of that game against an Aurora Christian team. But they have showed that, you know, they're capable of scoring fast.
Not much there. Let's get an update on Zach Hare with Matt Rodewald.
Well, Hare just got up. Looks like he's going back in right now. They were stretching his left leg and trying to work on that calf, possibly cramps. And yes, in the cold weather, you can get cramps if you don't intake enough water, Boomer.
My partner does not have any cramps tonight that I'm aware of. I haven't seen him limping around much, but he's been on that field for him. McNames will keep it. I haven't seen Connor McNames with the carry. Clock run at 3:40. St. Joe defense maybe looks a little tired. What about a timeout call by the Spartans? Is that an opportunity? Is that an option?
He's going to hurry it up.
And the pace belonging to Stephen Bailey. Hare hits hard. He's hit hard back. Did he get enough? fourth down and very short. He did get enough. And he'll come off again. Mark Stokes comes into the game to replace Hare. And he's going to get stretched out again. 3:20, clock on the move. McName's the key. McName's on his feet, inside the five.
McName's on the keeper.
So another little wrinkle thrown in here by Mike Lawler on this drive. The quarterback, the option keep.
Well, McName's is why he's such a valuable player, even in a triple threat, you know, offense, because a lot of it is based on timing, and he's making a split second decision on whether to hand the ball off to the fullback or not. I mean, that mesh point happens so fast with the fullback coming directly downhill. There is no sidestep. He's firing out of his stance, and it's up to McName's to give him the ball or keep it.
First and goal. Torrance spinning, and he comes up short, just turned away. Oh, he was looking across that goal line. I'm not sure. Maybe number four, Brady DePratt, that turned him around. Nevertheless, Dalton Walsh also in there. The ball will be inside the 1 yard line.
And the big guy is back in the game.
He will get it. And he'll be stopped. Boy, did they collapse on here. It's third down and goal.
There are some high impact collisions going on here. I mean, the game is being fought right there in the trenches, but the linebackers are coming downhill so hard. And the moment that some of these guys get the ball, you can just hear the pads crackle all the way up into the press box.
Third down, less than a yard. Here. Oh, they stop him again. He reaches.
He definitely.
He is short.
He's short. He got stopped there.
It will be fourth down and goal from inside the one. Look at the effort from the senior Zach here.
He gets hit right away in the backfield. At one point, it almost looks like he's a yard and a half back, but he keeps his momentum going. He tries to move his legs and reaches for the second effort.
Dip Duvall, he wants a timeout. He will get it with 1:21 to play in this game.
All right.
The ball is inside the 1 yard line. Again, that last run by Zach Hare. Let's see where that ball ends up here. Knee's still up. Well, he's down right there. It's hard to see where that ball may be in relation to that goal line.
It appears the ball is over the goal line. I'm not, you know, and you would think that maybe they, you can't say that they called him down by where his tail was sitting, because that was, you know, a yard and a half back.
Well, the last time that Stillman Valley was here, they pitched wide to Albers for a 3 yard touchdown run. The last two touchdowns we have had in this game have come on fourth down.
Hard to say what they're going to do. I mean, you know, they've been riding the horse all year long. Now you're at fourth and one, trailing in the fourth quarter of the state championship football game. You know, most likely you would just hand the ball to the big guy.
On fourth and less than a yard. Here, it is over.
Touchdown, Stillman Valley.
And the Cardinals answer. We've had six possessions in this second half. Every one has resulted in a touchdown. The last three have come on fourth down. And Zach Hare has pulled his team within one.
And they've done this, you know, now twice kind of on very short down. I mean, they're still essentially running the dive straight ahead, but it just kind of takes a little bit more of a lateral step to push it out a little bit wider. It was no secret that the ball was most likely going to Hare, so St. Joe's defenders were all pinching in.
Extra point attempt for the tie, and Keaton Weber sends it straight through. 1:19 to play in your state championship ball game, class 3A, and it's a 35-35 tie. We've talked about the boys of Stillman Valley. They took 4 minutes and 25 seconds off the clock. They go 60 yards. They use 12 plays. And they are tied at 35.
It's a great play drive by Stillman Valley. I mean, they stayed true to exactly who they are. Moved into the double tight, ran the true wishbone, and just pounded the ball all the way downfield. Ate up so much of the clock. But let's not forget, you know, SJO has done a great job today of moving the ball through the air. There's plenty of time left. You know, if they can utilize some of those out patterns and some of their deeper routes, you know, to kind of make the completions and move the ball downfield, stop the clock by getting out of bounds.
Stillman Valley has all three timeouts remaining. What happens on first and second down, very crucial to what they may do. These teams have had great field position to start their possessions, all scoring possessions in this second half. Stillman Valley has started out on average on their own 39. St. Joe Ogden starting on their own 38. Let's see how each team elects to handle it here, what Stillman Valley will do kicking off.
Well, SJO has playmakers at both levels of the kickoff return team. You know, they have Connor James in the second level, and they have Shody all the way back in the far. So, I mean, either way, if this ball is kicked, if it's squibbed, you have the possibility of getting it to one of your better offensive weapons.
Line drive kick. Not the average field position that either team has been used to. Let's take a look at our Burger King players of the game. First of all, for St. Joe Ogden, what a night the senior quarterback Dalton Walsh has had here this evening. Walsh, number 7, has thrown for 232 yards, 3 touchdowns. He's also done it on the ground. So Walsh, our St. Joe Ogden Burger King player of the game. On the other side, who else? Zach Hare. Touchdown runs, over 30 carries. But he has to sit and watch as the completion, again out of bounds. Been great sideline hitters run tonight by St. Joe Ogden.
5, second down and 5 at the 34-yard line.
Burger King players of the game, number 7, Dalton Walsh, number 39. He can still read it in the back of his jersey, Zach Hare. Numbers for Walsh. Another number is a 35-35 time. Walsh is not going to escape. He'll get about a yard and that's it. And a huge third down with the clock running. Underneath a minute to play. Stillman Valley with 3 timeouts remaining. St. Joe Ogden just 1. All right, here we go. Neither team going to stop that clock. Flips it out of bounds. He didn't like what he saw, and it's fourth down with 35 seconds left. Stillman Valley, all timeouts remaining.
This is a good decision. I mean, they're going to punt the football. I mean, you're so deep within your own territory. It's 4th and 5. There's 35 seconds left in the ball game. You don't want to risk going for it, not completing it, and handing the ball over to Stillman Valley, you know, at the 35-yard line.
First punt of the second half. Good snap. No pressure. And a good hop. Huey will just let it roll. And it will stop at the 17-yard line with 20 seconds left. Well, you're enjoying our 3A game. You'll enjoy 4A. It will be Geneseo taking on Rochester. Now, a reminder for our Comcast Sportsnet viewers, we'll be switching away from our IHSA coverage at the conclusion of this game. But what you need to do is go to csnchicago.com, find the CSN Plus channel in your area, and then switch over for the rest of tonight's coverage. 6:30 tonight. Will be simulcasting on both Chicago Sportsnet and Chicago Sportsnet Plus. So you have a little bit of time there to find your channel. Time, not necessarily in favor of Stillman Valley, 20 seconds. And they appear as if they're ready to play for overtime. We will have an overtime game in Class 3A. as we end regulation tied at 35. It doesn't get too much drama, too much more drama than this. You get yourself in a situation where you go back and forth and back and forth for the entire second half, and it's going to come down to an extra period or more. Along with Boomer Grigsby, I'm Dave Bernhard. This has been a flat-out fun game to announce and hopefully a fun game for you to watch. Now, here's how it works in high school football for those of you that aren't aware. Your high school football overtime looks like this. We'll get a coin flip to see what these teams want to do, go on defense or take the ball. It will start from the 10-yard line. You get four downs to go 10 yards. You can do whatever you want. You want to kick a field goal? You want to score that touchdown? Whatever you want. In this situation, Boomer, the advantage goes to the team who chooses to go on defense first, because defense, you say, okay, I'll know when I get the ball what I have to do offensively. I don't know if either team can stop the other, though. We may be here a while.
I mean, both teams have moved the ball so successfully that, I mean, it's been a shootout. I mean, it's unbelievable, and no one really predicted that this game would be this way, and you can't ask for a better state championship football game than 35-35 overtime.
There's Mike Lawler. He is out.
We're not in college.
In midfield for the coin flip. Lawler looking for his fifth state championship. Duvall coached against Lawler when Lawler was a player on a state championship team in 1989. See the captains, Herrera, Hare, along with Alberts. And now they will just let Hare make the call here. Now we'll see who does make the call. The visiting team here, of course, is St. Joe Ogden. Whoever wins the toss decides what they want to do with the ball. Want to play defense? Want to play offense? The ball will start at the 10-yard line no matter what. Here we go.
Drop it. We're going to do it again.
It's cold out there. Nice catch.
Okay. It's heads. Heads, you win the toss. Okay.
St. Joe Ogden says they will take defense. And on the other side, Stillman Valley will decide which end of the field they want to go. Okay, so the clock means nothing now. Each team gets an opportunity. There's one timeout per overtime period. And again, we can play as long as these teams remain tied. And Boomer, my feeling is this, and let me ask you, if these teams are driving 60 yards for scores and nobody can stop them, how do you stop them from 10? Is it a turnover game? Is it a trick play, or do you just say, hey, you know what, we're just going to go with it the way we have?
Well, I mean, I don't expect to see any trick play, but this is overtime of the state championship football game. I mean, both teams have played so well. I think, though, that still the advantage, if you had to say base, was still Stillman Valley is built around moving the ball 10 yards, where St. Joe has done a tremendous job of moving the ball downfield. But sometimes they work better with a little bit more space. They have the ability to run deeper routes and kind of cause more confusion into the secondary.
Our last overtime game in the state football finals came in 2009 in Class 7A. You're getting one here in Class 3A. Stillman Valley, the ball to start here at the 10-yard line. It's four downs. Why not? Here, the first carry. We'll get a couple, maybe three.
There's still a chance, but I mean, one unique part of this football game is we really haven't seen any turnovers. You know, neither team has fumbled the football, you know, at least for a loss. I mean, you know, a couple times the ball's been on the ground, but neither team has created a turnover.
Oh, great shot inside. Number four, Brady DePratt. Oh, did he undercut Zach Hare? They met at midfield for the coin toss, and they meet right here in overtime.
Doing such a great job as a linebacker. I mean, inside linebacker coming downhill, making contact, but realizing, you know, you're against a guy like Zach Hare, who's got a significant weight advantage and strength advantage on you, to go low, take his feet out from underneath him.
Third down and goal. Option, McNames keeps it. Still on his feet, he'll take it to the two. And that ball, though, was dropped after Names went down. It will be fourth and goal from the two. Well, as we said, we've had fourth down touchdowns tonight.
See the ball come out there on the end. I'm not exactly sure whether his knee was down. I mean, it's a hard thing to see.
Stillman Valley, first possession, first overtime. Hare powers it in. The official signal, touchdown. St. Joe Ogden thought they had a fumble. We'll take a look. Zach Harris had a habit of that ball coming out near the goal line. He wraps it up.
Oh, absolutely. That ball was out. The back of his body was turned towards the goal line. The ball had not crossed the line yet.
Well, there is no replay in high school football. So Weber lucky to stay perfect on the night. Now penalty flags come out. Stillman Valley has taken the 41-35 lead. Here's our call.
The ball, Coachman, on St. Joe.
Okay, for Grigsby. You go for two now, right? Ball now going to be at the 1.5 yard line. Here comes the offense. Big encroachment penalty. Looking for 2 points from 1.5 yards away. Looking to make this an 8-point game in overtime. Stillman Valley was going to be happy with one. They get two, and now they have forced St. Joe Ogden into a no-brainer decision. It's a score and a 2-point conversion attempt. That's what St. Joe Ogden will have to be to extend this to a second overtime.
What a confident call from Mike Lowther, going for it. 2-point conversion. There was an offside, so you're close. But I mean, it's fourth and one. 1.5 yards, get in the end zone. I mean, you're taking the risk, but you're understanding that you haven't been able to stop St. Joe all night long, so take advantage. Here's the touchdown. And you can see that ball was clearly out a little bit in the official's defense. I mean, there's so many people in the pile. You know, there's no replay in high school football.
If you indeed got the best look at it right there. Here we are, 10-yard line, Mike Lawler. Not many yards away from his fifth state championship. Motion from James. Walsh. He has some room to run. A flag is down behind the play. Walsh is down at the 5, but let's check out the flag. It may have been a block in the back, an illegal block. You may have heard it. It will go against St. Joe Ogden. Take a look at it. As Walsh was scrambling, here's the call first.
Block in the black.
See the defender cross his face, and then as Walsh rolls back to the left, the St. Joe offensive lineman tried to peel back a little bit.
Speaking of back, that's where this ball is going. Back to the 27-yard line. The huge contingent of Cardinals fans from Stillman Valley on their feet. It's first down. SGO must get into the end zone. Walsh finds his man, it's Stewart. He turns at the 10. He is inside the 5-yard line.
Incredible play. big penalty, backing you up, backing you all the way back. I mean, once again, you see him, he feels the pressure, does a little dancing, then escapes, rolling out to his right. And how well this kid has thrown the ball on the run. Just simply brilliant the way that he has been throwing the ball all game long, even in the moments of panic, and the way that his receivers have been working with him, knowing that his, their quarterback is in a scramble, and working with him that way along too, and along with coming back to the football.
Second and goal from the five.
Don't move.
Walsh again. Nearly intercepted, and that would have ended the game. Number 81, Matthew Lewis, looking right at it.
Stillman Valley was prepared for it this time, though. Matthew Lewis this time, earlier in the game, Connor James escaped out to the flat, and with the fullback sneaking into the flats for the touchdown. This time they stay in zone. They stay in their coverage. There's nowhere to throw the ball to, and had a big opportunity to finish the ball game.
Third down. James, he's in the end zone, and it's come down to a two-point conversion. How about St. Joe Ogden? Back to the 27-yard line, they get the touchdown.
The play call, even in overtime, mixing it up, going to the passing game, running some play action, and simply giving the ball to Connor James, who's been very successful all day long, running the ball between the tackles downhill.
Timeout called for the two-point conversion. We've got the 4A title game coming up following conclusion of this one. And again, just a reminder for our Comcast Sportsnet viewers, we'll be switching away from our IHSA coverage at the conclusion of this game. And all you have to do is go to csnchicago.com. That's csnchicago.com. That way you can find your CSN Plus channel in your area. You can switch now for the rest of tonight's coverage. csnchicago.com to find your Comcast Sportsnet Plus coverage. Dick Duvall, the call is made. A career that has spanned 26 years and 4 second place finishes. He needs 2 points to extend this game to another overtime. If that man right there, Mike Lawler, if his team can stop SJO, he will win his 5th title in Illinois.
Of course, I mean, you cannot make it any more dramatic. An overtime game that comes down to a two-point conversion.
Pressure, game over! Stillman Valley, your 3A state champions!
What a way to finish the football game. I mean, all game long, Stillman Valley has had no success in pressuring the quarterback. None whatsoever. Choose to fire blitz it. You know, all of your secondaries in man coverage, they send the house. Without a doubt, they get to him instantly, causing the sack and the football game. What a play call.
Logan Albert's number 2. Eddie Torrance, number 20. Walsh never had a chance.
They bring the pressure, but Logan Albert's just, being a smaller, more power, explosive guy, just kind of comes right off the ball in the sprinter stance, and there's nothing in between him and the quarterback, Walsh. He has no chance of eluding him, nowhere to go, nowhere to throw the football.
I don't know that you can get two opposite emotions on the two sidelines that you just saw.
You cannot ask for a better football game.
This was spectacular. Offenses answering every challenge, and then it became the defense that answered the final challenge for Stillman Valley. Mike Lawler won a state championship in 1989 as a player at Marion Central. That's when he was on a team that defeated Dick Duvall's first state finals team. Since then, Stillman Valley, with Lawler as head coach, won in 1999, 2000, 2003, and 2009 to go along with 2013. And now our country financial play of the game, the last play of a 43-41 game. It comes on the defensive side for Stillman Valley. Your country financial play of the game. Logan Alberts, Torrance, And that is a state championship win for the Cardinals. Oh, take a breath. We have interviews and trophy presentation. The big one going to Stillman Valley. Second place to St. Joe Ogden. What a beauty. 43-41 final. There's your final score in Class 3A. It comes in overtime. Stillman Valley 43-41 winners. And this is how it looked on the Stillman Valley sideline when Walsh went down with the sack. The Cardinals win their fifth state title. Let's go down to the field with Matt Rodewald.
Well, elation and excitement for Mike Lawler, who wins his fifth state championship. Coach, your defense could not get off the field until that last play with that sack. Tell me how impressive that was.
Yeah, I mean, we just kind of rolled the dice and brought everybody. They'd been moving the ball on us so well that it was kind of an all or nothing thing. We hope we could get them, and thank goodness we did.
I know you don't want to single anyone out, but Zach Hare's toughness shined and was evident today. How tough is he?
Yeah, he did a great job, not just running the ball, but he had a shoulder, kept popping out, he had a leg thing, and kept going over the sideline, getting those pop back in. And, that's kind of been the mantra of this team, just find a way to win and tough through the hurts because everybody was pretty banged up.
You've seen a lot of good state championship teams come through, beating Winnebago after losing to them, knocking on the division, and then winning in overtime here. That's as impressive as a run as you could probably have.
I think it really was. You know, we're able to beat some great teams, and Coach Duvall, my gut goes out to him today. He's a great friend of mine, he's been a great mentor, and just a tremendously good person. And have a game come down like that, just gut wrenching. And, our kids obviously continue to play hard and got things done.
Go celebrate with your team.
All right, I just wanted to say hi to my new little baby nephew, Titan, down there in Texas, and my dad's watching. I hope you're feeling better, and this one's for you.
All right. Thank you, Coach. Mike Lawler, the head coach who beat the player and as the coach beat St. Joe's. To Kelly now.
Well, Zach, what an incredible moment. I see you just falling into the arms of your coaches and players, giving them hugs. There's tears right now. Describe your emotions.
I mean, I'd like to describe it, but I just can't. I mean, it's just unbelievable how much we've developed as a family, and I love these guys, and I would do anything for them, and I know they'd do anything for me. So I think that's what molded us all together, was just being a family on the inside, and we just took care of things at the end.
You were really battling there for a while, definitely fighting some cramps or injuries, but to get that last touchdown, what did that feel like?
I just know I had to help my team out in any way possible. I mean, they told me, they gave me the ball, so I just run and see if I can get in the end zone, and I knew they needed me most, so I'd come in the most. So.
You just said this was maybe the best moment of your life. Why?
I mean, why not? Being able to come out here and spend all the time with my teammates, which are also my brothers, and I love the coaches, staff, I love everybody on this team.
Well, congratulations. Enjoy this one. Go be with your team. Dave, up to you guys.
Thank you very much, Kelly. And you get an idea of the emotion involved in this entire game. And of course, in the postgame, Mike Lawler, a little bit more understated, and Zach Hare, boy, he laid it all out there as we take a look at St. Joe Ogden getting their second place trophies. And as Mike Lawler said, Boomer, his heart goes out to Dick Duvall. You know, you like to compete against your friends. Sure, you like to beat your friends, but boy, you feel for them as well.
Oh, for sure. I mean, he has to be so proud, though, of his football team and everything that they've accomplished. And looking back and everything that he's accomplished in his whole career, I mean, it's still such a testament to make it all the way to the state finals game. I mean, runner-up or not, like, it is such a journey and it's so difficult, you know, playing IHSA playoff football, you know, to beat some of the opponents that he did and come along as far as they have.
This is the Menards Trophy presentation. Second place going to St. Joe Ogden. It's the fifth time they have been here and have raised that second place trophy. Never come closer than they have here tonight. On the other side for Stillman Valley, they'll get their trophy in just a second. But you look back, Boomer, here's Stillman Valley. They start the season 7-0. They finish the regular season with two losses. It's not like they're in shambles, but they had to regroup a little bit. Boy, that is a testament to the coaching staff, to the players, and the leadership.
Well, I think they stated it. I mean, it humbled them. And it kind of gave them that thirst back, you know, and that drive. I mean, there's a long story, you know, with Stillman Valley and the success that they've had and how great, you know, of a program that it's been. And I think, you know, those two losses at the end, some teams it could send into a downward spiral. But when you have a coach as successful as Mike Lawler and a team and a tradition like Stillman Valley, I think it just further brought out the best in them.
in this particular ball game. I don't know if I can recall a game that has gone back and forth with long sustained drives the way we saw here today.
Oh, I mean, it was incredible. I mean, you see that, you know, occasionally with both, you know, power rush team football, but then even then you'll see more big plays. I mean, both teams, you know, the score is almost hard to reflect how well both of them even played offensively and defensively. It was almost just, you know, assumed that each team was going to be able to score with the football. But yet, you know, how well they kind of played defensively at different times throughout the football game.
Number one. We were waiting for a possible turnover, and you would really have hated to see that, to see it a game decided on a turnover, maybe lumped onto one player. And the beautiful thing about this ball game is it didn't happen. Both teams just played hard, and in the end, it was the play call, the defensive play call. Let's go get the quarterback that ends the game.
Oh, aggressive play call. It was actually two aggressive play calls in overtime. I mean, when you think about it, you know, there's an encroachment penalty, you know, on the extra point kick. But with that in mind, it still doesn't mean that you have to go to two. It shows his incredible confidence in his offense and knowing that you're just going to hand the ball back to the big guy in order to get the two-point conversion. But, you know, I think he did that with confidence in his offense and also having the understanding that this was kind of catching a break. We're moving the ball a little bit closer. You know, we haven't been able to stop SJO all game long, but aggressive play call, very well done. It worked out, and they come out with the victory.
Your Menards Trophy presentation to your Class 3A state champions, Stillman Valley Cardinals.